and we edited the film in the spring and summer of 2011, and it was on PBS in February 2012, and right before that, we were invited to the Sundance Film Festival. And, you know, I've done lots of documentaries about African-American history, from Rise on the Prize to The Rise and Fall of Jim Crow, to a series called I'll Make Me a World about African-American artists. But I found this one to be one of the most important that I've ever done. And I think one of the things that makes this film stand out from among the other films I've done is that in this particular film, that you don't usually see in other historical documentaries, we had people who had descendants, who were descendants, both black and white, who were able to come on screen and sort of tell their family story and recognize, particularly the white descendants, the horrors of their ancestors. And it was in an interesting way, sort of a turning point for the film, because initially I had resisted the idea of having descendants in the film. But through Doug's persistence and the persistence of our executive producer, Catherine Allen, they persuaded me to interview some of these people, and I really think it really paid off. And I think this is a film that should be shown through schools, from middle school through universities. I think it's a very important film, a very important part of America. I want to emphasize those two words, American history.
Now, you know, when Lincoln said, if I could save the Union without freeing any slaves, I would. So it wasn't that he had a heart of gold, but he was a practical person. And he knew the way this the country was divided in this manner, half enslaved and half not, couldn't survive. And so at the end of the day, he made a very practical political, you know, solution. And the solution was, I'm going to free these particular Africans in the South. That will now undermine the Southern economy, but it would also give soldiers to the Union Army. So it held both ways. It's a very practical solution to this. But the concern I have is the change in the political climate when he was assassinated. Then Johnson comes in, and Johnson wants to appease the South, and that's when we leave, you know, the Africans basically out vulnerable because we've taken away the soldiers who are protecting them and ending Reconstruction. So we start off early on with anti-Ku Klux Klan Act, and then the Civil Rights Act. You think of the 1964 Civil Rights Act as the Civil Rights Act. The Civil Rights Act began in the 1860s, and they began in the 1860s because the federal government knew the state governments were not going to protect the rights of the free Africans. They knew it. The federal government knew that the sheriffs and the local law enforcement would not protect those rights. They knew the courts would not uphold those rights. So they had an overlay of federal civil rights laws that were put in place to protect blacks who wanted to vote, to protect blacks against oppression and terrorism, against the Ku Klux Klan. They had those provisions placed in there. The concern, once again, is then they lost the political will. Because as the smaller legislations began to enact the black codes, that led to Plessy versus Ferguson in 1896. So when Plessy versus Ferguson happened, and you know the story of Plessy, of course you do. He was an octoroon, Plessy was, Homer Plessy was an octoroon. And he was a civil rights activist in New Orleans. They had civil rights activists before Thurgood Marshall. Still, there were civil rights activists back then. And they saw these segregationist laws being put in place. They saw these peonage things. They saw all these things happen, and they wanted to step up and do something about it. So Plessy decided he was going to board a railroad car that was intrastate. It's like it wouldn't be in New Jersey, New Jersey, no better. Think of a railroad that's just within the boundaries of the state. And so in boarding that train, he decided he's not going to sit in a designated black section, which was in the front of the train, so all the smoke and the soot from the engine would fly in. They only had a hole in the floor for a toilet. I mean, it was despicable. And the white section was totally different. So he said, I'm going to sit in the white section. Now, he's an octoroon. An octoroon means he's 1/8 black. So he's so light, and it's like some people are like, I'm so light. Yes, but you have to be able to pass for white, and he could. Not just be light. You know, it's not in your mind, you might look like you think you're almost passing for white. You have to be able to actually go to a plan B and not be discovered. So now he sits there, the conductor comes in, somehow, this history tells different stories, the conductor knew who he was, either by his activism in the community, he knew who he was, and he arrested him, and then Homer Plessy appeals his arrest, challenging the segregationist law that separates blacks and whites on railroad cars. He was told not to follow through with this case. He was told of the 9 Supreme Court justices, there weren't enough. You need 5 in order to overturn these laws. But he said, I'm going to do it anyway. He takes the case to the U.S. Supreme Court, and that's where we get separate but equal from that Plessy case. And they decide that states can then segregate by race. They don't have to, but if they want to, they can. And of course, by then, everybody wanted to. And just to have the effect on voting rights, which I think is very important, because as these people in peonage were taken out of the social system, they were also taken away from any ability to vote, to change the politicians who were in place, making the laws, creating the segregation of society. And so from 1896, in I believe it was Louisiana, there were over 100,000 registered black voters. Over 100,000. By 1900, after Plessy versus Ferguson had been in place, that number was down to a little over 5,000. So once you see how the federal government, you know, the U.S. Supreme Court, which is a federal government, now rules these people don't deserve to be in the same space, the same social setting, and everything's a social setting. This is a social setting that would have to be segregated. A theater is a social setting. Black people are sitting at the top and whites, you know, below. Bathrooms are a social setting. Even a cemetery was a social setting. There was a black cemetery and a white cemetery. Yes, and actually that's the last segregated place there is. There are still black morticians and white morticians. And to the point there were black hospitals and white hospitals. Everything was segregated. We think about it, schools and water fountains, but it even had segregated windows. It's because what happens, you look out the window and you might say, wow, it looks like it's going to rain. Someone responds, yes, I think so. You had a social setting. So you can't even look out the same window at the same time. So when you think about how society was segregated and harsh during that time period, then you can better understand when it comes down to the criminal justice system, how they could treat people in this despicable way. Because even people who were free had, and people of color, not just black, but also Native American, Asian, Latinos, how people were treated during that time period, to better understand how they turned a blind eye to the treatment of those people in prison.
But you were going to talk about the setting of, I mean, I think what happened in the 1880s and the 1890s in the South was the beginning, was the incubation for the prison and industrial
Definitely. Yeah, it was. As a matter of fact, many of you, I'm sure, know about the prison industrial complex and the idea that we have these prisons located in rural communities in which people are worked. They work. They might have made this furniture in here, especially since this is a state college. Because since they work for the state, yes, they make the furniture for the state, and they have other types of jobs they do. Why isn't it peonage? Why isn't it indentured servitude? Why isn't it slavery? What do you think? Because they're paid something. Yes, they're paid like 10 cents a day. So if they're paid something, you're not enslaved. So then that makes a difference. Many of you will have this Constitution, and you'll see within the Constitution, it's the U.S. Constitution in African-American context. And in this Constitution, I've highlighted and annotated the places within the Constitution referring directly or indirectly to people of African descent. There are more references to people of African descent in the U.S. Constitution than to any other particular group. The 3/5 clause is in Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution. under the three-fifths clause, we know that people of African descent were counted as three-fifths of a person to determine the number of representatives in U.S. Congress. They were counted as three-fifths of a person to determine the number of representatives in U.S. Congress. Think about it today. And today the issue we have is African Americans and other people who are now sequestered in these rural communities. They're counted in the population of those rural communities. So in being counted in those populations, they then increase the resources for those communities. And in increasing the resources, it gives them political power. Because then they would have more representatives than they normally would have. They would have more state and federal funding. And so we have also the gerrymandering. But and now there's a mechanism in place where people are attempting to have those prisoners counted in their local communities as opposed to being counted in the prison community. But, you know, of course that's being fought because why would somebody give up that political power?
Truly wasted.